Hello Retrofans, today I like to give you a short overview of the configuration and the update procedure of the FPGA SID. And when you have seen my previous video about the installation of the FPGA SID, I changed the board right now, so I moved on to the reloaded MK1 board. And interestingly, this board is fully prepared to work in a 2-sit mode. And as you can see, the configuration or the wiring is a little bit different. So there is actually a kind of a jumper or a socket on the top of the SID socket, where we can access most of the things we're going to need for running the FPGA SID in stereo mode. So the A5 line, which is the yellow wire, and the IO1 line, which is the red wire, is already accessible on this point. It's just the A8 line needs to be accessed from the CPU, so you have to use the clamp on this pin. And that's pretty handy. It's a little bit weird that the A8 line isn't available here as well, so if you just want to play stereo SIDs on a certain address, the D420, then this line is not required. And the next handy thing is that the stereo signal, or the signal of the second SID, can be routed onto this socket as well. And then it is fully available on the stereo output of the reloaded MK1. So basically, it is not required to do any soldering or something like this. So you can put on the FPGA SID on this reloaded MK1 board, and then you connect the clamps, and then you're ready to go. And that's a pretty comfortable thing. And as the next thing, I'm going to show you how we have to configure the FPGA SID in order to use the different modes. And for this, we're going to switch over to the C64 view. And as you can see, I'm using my SD2IC device, and we will talk about later of about one of the major advantages of using the SD2IC device in conjunction with the FPGA SID. But as a first step, we need to load the program we're going to use. And it's my messy directory, but somewhere there should be the program, call it Configuru, and we can find it here. And let's use the normal load command. And I'm using Jiffy DOS a lot, so I'm used to the shortcuts which we can use. But as you can see, it works on a normal C64 as well. So, and this is basically the start screen of the Configuru. And here we have basically four different menus. And the first one is the easy menu, and it is really meant like this. We got just a few options to select, and then that's basically all we can do on this screen. And the interesting thing here is that we really can configure the FPGA SID to either run in a normal one SID mode, in a so-called pseudo stereo mode, or in a full stereo mode. And the main difference here is that the mono mode and the pseudo stereo mode are basically single SID modes, and just the full stereo mode is the 2-sit mode, which can be configured in a different way. And as the next thing, we can see SID 1 and SID 2, and here we can select whether we want to use the newer model, the 8580, or the older model, the 6581. And by just pressing a key, we can switch between the SID models. And this selection is rather important for the two different stereo modes. So in mono mode, it's just SID1 that's in usage, and therefore we just have to configure set one. And in pseudo stereo mode and in full stereo mode, we are going to use sit two as well. Although in pseudo stereo mode, sit two is playing the very same as sit one. What's going to be the benefit of this? I'm going to explain on the next screen. And for those of you who are not familiar with the different SID models, as a main orientation, we can say that most of the older C64 and the bread bin case are using most of the time the older SID, the 6581. And most of the newer C64, the C64-2, in this kind of flat case are using mostly the 8580s. And since Commodore was mixing up things a lot, this is just a rule of thumb and may not apply to all of the models out there. I got some bread bin cases with the newer SIDs, and I got even the flat case C64 with an older SID. So you either have to have a look inside, or you have to play certain SID songs to kind of recognize the difference. So, and the last option we have here is the so-called digifix. And this is a thing that has, well, quite some importance if you want to play older digitalized sounds on a newer SID chip. So if you may know the famous Turrican opening speech, or if you know this Outrun Europe count in, for example, these are things made for the older SID, and on newer SIDs you may not hear this, or it's not as loud as it is on the older SID. And this so-called digifix, or digfix as it here as it is called here, just to the limitation in space, is kind of addressing this issue. So you may or may not use this option. And then we can see it as an active config A, and we see that we have memory A, memory B. And the interesting thing is that with an additional switch added to the FPGA SID, we are able to switch between the two configs. So if I'm going to press the button, we can see it's active config B. And if I kind of release the button, then we have a active config A. And that's very interesting if you want to switch between SID models, for example, or if you want to have two distinct configuration, and without going to config guru all the time, you can store them in either A or B, and then you simply switch between them. And the interesting thing as well about the MK1 board, if you just switch over to the camera view, there is a so-called jumper 13, which is not labeled on the board, but it's close to this U21. And we got two different kind of pins here, or kind of soldering holes, which are not soldered. And we have the first one is saying option select. And this can be used to toggle the configuration of the FPGA SID. If you perform a reset and press the fire button on joystick port 2, this signal will go in a high state, and then we can trigger the second configuration of the FPGA SID. I haven't done the wiring yet because I want to stick to, let's say, most of the stock options. But on this board it's very comfortable, and if you're familiar with other add-ons for the C64, like the Keyman 64, for example, then this would be an option to use hotkeys on the keyboard to toggle the configuration of the FPGA SID. So much about this. Let's dig into the details, and the first thing I'm going to present is the difference between an 8580 and a 6581 SID. And I've picked a newer title because here the difference is very audible, it's very good to hear. And I I was a little bit surprised by my my sudden action of activating the video, and I don't want to talk over the music. So I think you were able to hear the difference between the two different SID modes, and it is almost the same for older titles composed for the older SID. So you will find differences like this as well. And so much about the different SID models. So as a rule of thumb, if you, let's say, buy newer games for the C64, like Sam's Journey or this YOM 64, which we have seen right now, or all those newer Psytronic releases or RGCT releases, most of those things, games, whatever, are using the newer SID model. And if you are really looking back in time, say talk about 80s and 90s, most of this stuff has been produced for the older SID, and therefore you're quite flexible with your SID model, and you do not have to disassemble your C64 all the time if you want to switch between those times, or well, game titles, whatever. So, and the next thing I'm going to talk is going to talk about is the so-called pseudo stereo. I don't know whether the pronunciation is right, but well, let's stick to this. And I have prepared an example for this as well, and this is a title that starts with single voices. And the main purpose for this pseudo stereo mode is, if you're going to switch over to the expert screen, then we can see that we have kind of a mess of options. But if we just stick to, let's say, the upper section of the screen, we have the SID 1 on the left side and SID 2 on the right side. And maybe the third line or the fourth line, I don't know where we start to count with, it's saying mute. And here we can see that voice, VOC 3, is highlighted on the left side, and VOC 1 is highlighted on the right side. And this means that in this mode, the two SIDs are playing the very same, but one voice is muted on either side. And if you're going to route the audio signal through your speakers and have SID 1 on your left speaker and SID 2 on your right speaker, then you will have some missing voices on each side. And this creates a very interesting stereo effect. And depending on your personal preference, whatever, this can have a very nice effect on certain titles. And just to demonstrate this, I've created a short video. I'm going to show you this as an audio example. Thank you. So depending on which voice has been muted, you will have at least one voice that's playing on both channels. In this case, it's a VOC 2, a voice 2. And either voice 1 or voice 3 is playing on the left or on the right side. And this depends a little bit on the title. So some titles are kind of, let's say, stick to a certain pattern. So they have the drums on voice 1 and they have the lead melody on voice 2 or something like this. And by configuring this mute options, you are able to kind of center the sound so that you have the drums in the middle, not on just one channel or something like this. But this heavily depends on the song or on the title, and therefore it may require some testing or, let's say, fiddling to get it right. But this can be a very interesting option. And the cool thing is that the Config Guru or the FPGA set keeps the configuration until the next reset or until you power off the board. So you can easily jump out of the program, test your title, jump back to the program, and you do not have to flash the configuration every single time. So, and as the next thing, we have the so-called filter section, which is more on the bottom of the screen. And here we can see that depending on which SID model has been selected, we have different filter options. And the filter is what makes the SID so famous, because it is not just a three-voice oscillated sound device. It is really an advanced synthesizer chip which utilizes different types of filters. And the very tricky thing with the 6581 SID chip is that the filter is very different from SID chip to SID chip. So it is kind of unpredictable how a title will sound on different C64s. The 8580 is more stable in this behavior, so it's actually not a big issue to create titles for the 8580. They will sound almost the same on all different C64s as long as they have the same SID chip. But for the 6580 it is very tricky. And some musicians were quite famous for not using any filters at all, because they were kind of annoyed by this unpredictable behavior. But others didn't care that much about this and created their own music using a certain 6580 SID they have owned or something like this. And therefore we have strong and weak filter settings. And if you're going to switch to the different SID models by simply just changing our configuration to the 6581, then we can see that on the export screen we have a now so-called bias, a filter bias. And here we can select how strong the filter works on the 6581. And in order to present you this, I have created an audio sample as well. So let's listen to this next title and then we can see how this setting is going to affect the sound. So, perhaps it was not as clear as possible, But if we compare the weak against the strong setting, we may recognize that on the strong setting, one voice is almost missing completely. And on the weak setting, this voice is normally filtered. So I think this was the intention of the musician as he was creating the Sid song. And therefore, it is really a little bit, let's say, fine tuning. So especially for this older Rob Hubbard songs, you need to have a very weak filter. And Tim Fulin, for example, was using quite weak filters as well. But for other titles, you may need a stronger filter to have any filter effect at all. So this is really kind of a personal preference as well, and this needs some kind of fine tuning and practice to find the right setting. But it is very, very beneficial that we can simply select this in this option screen. In a real world scenario, you would have to change the 6580 SID in order to accomplish different sound settings. And while I was testing the new SID replacements like the ARM SID, the SwinSID Ultimate, and the FPGA SID, I was searching in my collection of SID chips to find similar models. So I was looking for a 6580 SID chip with very weak filters. And surprisingly, I found a lot of older SIDs with very strong filters. And the one that came quite close to this kind of weak setting, what we can see here right now, this BIOS plus 3, was the 6580R4RA, which is one of the latest 6581 SID models built ever. And this series of SID models has quite constant filter settings. So if you pair two of them in a stereo SID configuration, they are almost quite close to each other. But for the older models, it is really hard to find matching pairs. So what else do we have on this screen? We have the so-called X-In, and this is an abbreviation for external in. Every SID chip has an audio input signal. And here we can decide what we are going to do with this audio signal. So we can use this analog in, which is usually available on the video audio socket. And it is quite normal for the 6580 that if you're not going to use this audio in, you simply mute this. And this will reduce noise on the 6580. So this is a little bit different for the FPGA SID, because this one is not a real 6581 SID, and therefore we are not going to have the noise. But if you have something connected on your C64 that may provide an audio signal, and even if it's just noise, and you don't want to have this in your audio output, then you just simply set this to mute. And then we have the chance to route either a SID 2 into SID 1 or SID 1 into SID 2, and this can be used to mix audio signals as well. And this is kind of a solution to use just one audio output to play two SIDs over one line, but it's not a real let's say mixer, because the audio in of a SID is routed through the filter section of the SID as well. And therefore, the sound of the second SID will be filtered by the first SID, and this may sound a little bit different than expected. So, but if you're using a synthesizer software, or if you want to produce your own sounds using stacked filters or something like this, this could be an interesting option. And the next thing we can see here is the so-called DIG FX, what we have on the first side already. That's the DIGI fix. And here we can select whether we're going to use this or not. Just was jumping away from it. And we can insert values here and this is basically kind of a volume. So, and that's almost what we have to talk about this section. Then we have different waveforms, and this is unique for the 6580. The 6580 SID chip is not able to use all waveforms at once, whereas the 8580 is able to use all the waveforms in a mixed format as well. And here we can select whether our emulated SID is using the older or the newer behavior. I'm not really sure where this could be used, but well, at least it's an option. So, and then we have the so-called read register, and this is important for detecting which SID is installed on your C64. And I learned that some of the demos are using this to detect which SID is used in your C64. And if your SID, or if your virtual SID, your emulated SID, is not detected properly, you may play with the different options here. So, then we move on to the next page. I think we have covered already all the stuff here. Or maybe let's talk briefly about the SID to address selection. As you can see, we have four different options, and the D400 is the standard address of the SID1. So if SID2 is set to the same address, it's going to play the very same like as SID1. But if we set this to a different address, 420, 500 or E00, then we can address this, or we can use the second SID really as an independent device. And this is for the stereo configuration, and this depends on the SID title you want to play or the program you're going to use. So there are different programs out there which are able to use a second SID. So most of the stuff is usually running on the D420 or D500 addresses, but if you are going to use, for example, Messiah, then this program is looking for the second SID at the DE00 address. And this is normally somewhere in the documentation or somewhere in the info or help screen. You can find this. And SynthCard, for example, which is a very interesting synthesizer as well, is available in different versions and therefore can use different addresses as well. So, the next thing we're going to see, have a look at, is a diagnostic screen. And here we can hear quite annoying beep, but this is a screen to test whether your FPGA SID is installed properly and it's working fine. And here we can see that the LEDs are lighting up in a certain order. If we're just going to switch over to the camera view, then we can see that this is going to cycle through the three different LEDs here. And depending on this, we have an audio channel left, right, and the external in, which we have basically muted. And if we're going to use pedals, for example, then we can check whether the pedals are working here as well. I'm just going to see whether I can emulate this with my gamepad. No, I do not have pedals connected, so I cannot demonstrate this right now. And we can see what kind of C64 model we are using. So that's the PAL model. And if we're going to install the FPGA SID in a C128 model, then we can see whether the FPGA has detected that he is installed in a non-C64 model. So, and well, that's basically all we can see and use in this screen. And the next thing, and that's going to be a little bit more complex, is the so-called flash screen. And in order to see this a little bit better, let's switch view. And here we can see which FPGA revision we are using right now. So I'm using the 09 version, and that's the version that's on the FPGA set when it is shipped. And this screen can be used to update the FPGA set. And if we're going to switch over to the FPGA set page, I can show you where you can find the related information. So that's the start screen of the FPGA set page, and we can find a lot of interesting information here. So we got some news message on this side, and then we can go through different pages like specification. It's a lot of technical information about the FPGA sets, and then we have project updates. That's basically the extended content of the front page, and then we have the documentation screen. And this is a very important page, because here we can find everything related to the installation of the FPGA, is it the configuration of the FPGA, is it which is kind of a text format of what I have told you right now. And we have the latest firmware and software, and we have some technical documents. And there is even an FPGA set YouTube channel where you can find videos about most of the topics here as well. And what's interesting right now is the latest firmware and software. And the program I have showed you right now is the Config Guru, and this can be found as a separate program, and it is included in the firmware releases as well. So, and the firmware release is basically a huge zip file, and it's available on Google Drive. And if we go into this folder, we can see here's the Config Guru, and we have the so-called binaries, that's the firmware itself, and we have a disk image. And we can see we have a D64 format, and we have the D81 format. And if we want to update the firmware of our FPGA set, then I highly recommend to either copy all those files to your SD2IC device, or you copy the D81 file to your SD2IC device, or if you really want to use a normal floppy drive like the D64, then you have to copy those two files to either two separate disks or to two separate disk sites. And there is some kind of, let's say, tricky thing if we talk about upgrade of the FPGA set. And was it here? Yes, okay. So for a C64, the amount of data that needs to be flashed on the FPGA set is quite huge. So therefore we either have to use two disk sites, or we switch over to the D81 format, or we're going to use an SD2IC device and copy the raw files onto it. And as we can see, this will have a major impact on the flashing time, on the upgrade time. So a normal C64 with a standard 1541 floppy drive will take about 70 minutes and 30 seconds to update the FPGA set, which is indeed a very long time. If you're going to use a real 1581 drive, it takes 4 minutes less, about. And if we're going to use a C64 with 5041 disk drive and a Jiffy DOS, we are down to 3:30, but we still have to change disks. And if you're going to use an SD2IC device with Jiffy DOS as well, then we are down to 36 seconds. And that's the main reason why I am using my SD2IC device for this project. I mean, since the appearance of the P1541, I kind of abandoned the usage of the SD2IC device, but it still has a lot of benefits, and one of the major benefits is that it works very well in conjunction with Jiffy DOS. And I have Jiffy DOS installed on this reloaded MK1 board, therefore this custom EEPROM here. I'm using a different kernel, and the SD2IC device is utilizing, or well, it's kind of using the Jiffy DOS fast loader. There are other fast loaders as well, which works together with the Jiffy with the SD2IC device with the latest firmware. So as you can see, I'm on 1.0.0, which is almost the latest version available right now. And there will be a next video about how to update an SD2IC device, especially how to recover it when it is dead. And anyway, that's not going to be the topic today, but we're going to flash the newest prototype, alpha, tester, whatever firmware onto the FPGA set. And as a first step, and this is what I really, really recommend, is that you use check disk. And if we're going to press this, then we will see that we haven't inserted the right disk. Well, we are in the root directory of the SD2IC device. So now we have to jump out of this and select the correct directory. So, and we can make this quite easy. And here we go. It looks a little bit weird, but as you can see, I have the different disk images on this SD2IC device. And what's looking so strange here, oops, is basically the raw file format. And now we can read this again. FPGA SID binary 1200123456 7. And I have no idea what it is loading right now, but we'll be surprised. And as I said, we can either use the D81 format, or we use the RAW format and read it directly from the FPGA SID, from the SD2IC device. And in order to do so, we're going to load Config Guru again. Should be done in a matter of seconds, so I think something has been. Kind of mixed up, so let's try it again. Yeah, this looks much better. So, and it's basically the same screen, and if you're going to the flash menu and say check disk, then we can see that it has started to use something. And revision found on disk is 0A, so that's a little bit different compared to 0.9. But this is actually just a test firmware for a limited pool of people. And if you're going to buy the FPGAs, it is actually shipped with firmware revision 09. So disk check passed, okay. And this is really important. If you encounter any issues here, then really check your setup. If you're going to start the update procedure and something happens in between, this may break your FPGA set. And in order to bring it back to life, you have to use a programming device and this GTAG connector, and then you have to flash the firmware onto the FPGA SID with the help of an PC or whatever machine. But here it looks like everything is fine. So now we have the chance to step out of this, or we say run flash, and this is what we are going to do. And there's another question: are you really sure? Yes, indeed. And here's a screen saying do not turn off the computer. So now it's really important that everything runs through fine. And as we have seen, this program needs to read 8 different files and copy them over to the FPGA SID. And this is represented by this kind of cursor screen. And hopefully there will be no issue at the end. Writing successful. Okay, so current FPGA revision OA. So we're going back to diagnostics. We should see this somewhere else. Not here. Oh yes, firmware is OA. A 0A. Okay. So everything has worked fine. Okay, and that's basically everything I was going to present today. So we went through the different option screens, talked about briefly about the different options and the effect of this, and I don't think I have missed something so far. No. And well, if you have any questions, if you want me to check something specifically on this FPGA, is it a certain song, a certain demo, a certain game or something like this, then please let me know in the comment section, and I will hopefully prepare the example as soon as possible. Or if you want to know something more about how to install the FPGA SID on certain boards, if you want to see some real life examples, how to do this wiring, how to access the stereo signal or something like this, then well, feel free to ask. I'm more than willing to address this. And yeah, that's basically all I have to say for today. So as usual, thank you very much for watching. If you want to stay informed, then feel free to subscribe or follow me on Twitter. And yeah, I hope you will see us for the next episode. And then, bye-bye.